the Joan Quinn Profiles. As an editor for Andy Warhol's Interview, the Los Angeles Herald Examiner, LA Style, and Detour magazines, Joan covered the social set, the Hollywood hotshots, the international art scene, the mysteries of food, the excitement of travel, and the fabulous world of fashion. Joan continues to find creative people on the cutting edge who make things happen. Here's Joan Agajanian Quinn.
Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome to the Joan Quinn Profiles. Waiting to be profiled are actress Sheryl Lee Ralph and director Karen Landry. Actress, singer, producer, writer, and award-winning director Sheryl Lee Ralph, who was born and raised in New York, is with us today. And Sheryl Lee was the first and youngest woman to graduate from Rutgers College. In 1977.
My God, you gotta give them dates? Gee whiz.
She launched her career in a feature film with Sidney Poitier and Bill Cosby. Well, tell me how that happened.
Oh my goodness. Well, first of all, you left out the part that of all those things, I'm your friend and that's why I'm here. Our kids go to school together.
Exactly.
You know, and that's how these things happen. That's the important part.
That's part of your persona.
Thank you.
You've been so great. You are the best mother.
You know, I really try. Of all the things that I do, I think one of the things that I've really excelled at is being a mother. You know, being a wife to my husband and being a daughter to my parents.
And your mother must have been a great mother to get in college and get you out at 19 years old. How did that happen?
My parents are perfectly imperfect, and had they not been the people that they are, I would never be the woman that I'm still becoming. Perfectly imperfect. You know, my parents were always aware of the fact that they were doing their best. My father would always say, you know, I may not have all the answers, but I have most of the answers you will need. My father used to always say to me, I don't expect me to agree with everything, but I will listen to everything, and I will love you unconditionally.
And I think that's what you've done with your kids. And what else can you do? I know, it's great. Well, tell me, was there music in your family?
Always music. My dad's a great musician. In fact, he wrote the cantata for the state of Connecticut. And it's called,
is that right?
Absolutely. And it's called The Nutmeg. And it's written into their constitution. When you look up all of the things about the state cantata is The Nutmeg, written by Dr. Stanley Ralph.
Well, how did he get to Connecticut? Or how did Connecticut get to him?
My grandfather and my grandmother made that migration from the South. You know, I believe in the 30s and the 40s, where black people were leaving the South and migrating to bigger cities. You know, a lot of people, you know, I've heard stories about there were these bus stops where tickets were issued to people and you chose where you were going to go. Some people went to Chicago. A lot of people went to the state of Pennsylvania and others went to Connecticut.
That was fantastic, wasn't it, that they did that? They just got on a bus.
Bus and they went, which I thought was, wow, how interesting, you know. I don't know if I would have that kind of guts.
I always say that about people who came from, say, Armenia, like my grandfather. How would you, 18, 19, how would you do that?
Exactly. You know, to me, it's just, the whole thought is just amazing. And my grandmother, the story is said that she left because she was being amorously shown affection to by a numbers runner, and her family didn't want her to have anything to do with that side of life.
But you see the morals and the mores that you had and that those people had in their families, and that's what we carry on. So your father was obviously musical. He wrote the cantata.
That's right.
And did
he graduated,
teach you?
No. My dad and I had a falling out about piano rehearsal.
I wonder why.
Okay, it was practice. And if there was one thing I was good at, it was not practicing.
Oh, I see.
And one day, you know, my dad and I are very close, and he hit me over the knuckles with a ruler. And I was just so shocked that he hit me. And I never practiced again. And that was it. And he was so upset that he hit me, and he hit me on the knuckles, and that was it.
But that was good, because you started singing.
Yes.
And that was and the beginning of your career.
That's it, because that way he played the piano, and all I had to do was stand there and sing.
Yeah, because who knows where you'd be now? You know, maybe would be accompanying the Dream Girls instead of being the Dream Girls.
How about that? How about that?
But
I could have been a Democratic Condoleezza Rice, though.
Oh,
she does everything.
I know. Yes. She plays the piano, too,
exactly,
doesn't she?
Beautifully.
I think you would have been great.
You
would have been wonderful in foreign affairs.
See what I'm saying? I think so. I think about that myself
as well.
Well,
didn't you ask President Obama to do anything for you?
I worked very, very hard for the president. Very, very hard. So hard that I received in the mail a few months ago a t-shirt from Iowa.
Oh, a t-shirt.
A t-shirt from Iowa, and it was from a group of people that I spoke to. They sent out very, very early representatives for the president, for the then senator of Illinois. And a surrogate. I was an early surrogate. And I spoke to a group in Iowa, and I received this t-shirt from the group saying, "You're the reason why we voted."
Is that right?
Yes.
But
and
you
I was
speak,
so pleased.
Since you're talking about that, you speak to a lot of groups. You're on campus a lot.
Yeah.
And how does that, and what do you say, and why are you there?
You know, when I do my traveling around to campuses and schools, you know, that's around my activism around HIV and AIDS.
Right. Oh, is that
so,
what it's...
Exactly.
That's the focus?
That's really what it is. And now, since all of the work around HIV and AIDS, in fact, my husband, Senator Vincent Hughes, and I created something called Test Together, where we encourage couples to go and get tested together. And we take it even further and say it doesn't have to be a romantic couple. It can be a mother and a child, a father and a son. Teach your children how to be sexually responsible. Show them by leading by example. And it's as simple as going to testtogether.org, putting in your zip code, and a number of places will come up around your city, your
where
state,
you go.
Where you can go and get tested for free.
But I think that's also part of what you learned as having good morals and also going out and helping in the community.
Being responsible to your community.
Right.
You know, there's a saying that says, to whom much is given, much is expected. So if you know better, you've got to do better.
Expected, because people who can do a lot are always expected to do more.
Absolutely.
And it's true. In addition to that speaking, you made a film, Secrets.
I did a film called Secrets.
Does that have anything to do with what your talks are about?
You know, Secrets was one of those things I felt back, believe me, I did Secrets, I believe I started it in 1990, and it was all about five friends who planned the whole wedding of the last to get married, and the bombshell is dropped about who her intended is having an affair with, and who he's having an affair with changes everything. And people said to me at that time, but that doesn't really happen. That's a fairy tale. Well, now we know in this day and age, if you were to tell that same story now, we'd be talking about men on the down low, men who sleep with other men but do not represent themselves as being gay men.
That's what we see in Secrets.
In Secrets. That's what Secrets is all
and,
about.
And you had fantastic award-winning stars as part of it. Were they your friends?
Yes. How I cast the piece was calling my friends, like you called me. I called up Alfre Woodard. Alfre Woodard said, I love this script. She said, you got to call LaTanya Jackson, Samuel L. Jackson's wife. She read it. She said, I love it. You got to meet my friend, Victoria, who was also a friend of mine.
I love Victoria
Rowell. Yeah. Her new book, Secrets of a Daytime Diva.
She's great.
She is so fantastic.
She's
and
beautiful.
Her whole story around her life as a foster child. Such a great story and a great person.
She is a real activist, too.
Yes.
She's worked a lot foster children
That's
in
right.
homes from Boston. Did
That's
you know
right.
her in the
yes,
East?
She does. She's a New Englander as well.
I know.
That's right.
So it was a short film. How short was it?
It was 12 minutes long.
And you got all that in 12 minutes?
All of that in 12 minutes. I won the Showtime Black Filmmakers Award. I won the HBO Filmmakers Award. I won the Outfest Audience Favorite Award. I won several different awards.
Because you wonder, where do you show short films?
Yes, at At film festivals.
At film festivals.
In the short category. Right.
And usually in film festivals, they're independent films.
That's right.
And you got a Best Supporting Actress for an independent film.
Yes, I got Best Supporting Actress for a film that I really, really loved called To Sleep With Anger. And it was just so amazing when I won the award because there was so much talk going on about you could be nominated for an Oscar and all of that.
Oh right, because that's what happens with the independent awards, right?
And I'll never forget Robert De Niro said to me, you know, we were doing another film called Mistress, and he said, you know, you got to wave the red flag. He said, because you're a great actress and you should go far, but they're not looking for the black actress. So for as long as you can remember and as long as you can, wave the red flag and let them know that you're there because you deserve more.
Oh, he's great.
And
well, he's a good pusher for all people. So we jumped ahead of our story,
yes. But
when did you start writing and directing?
Oh, I think, you know, I started writing. Writing was the last course I took at Rutgers.
In college?
Yes, it was the last course I took. And I was always so sad because I remember my teacher, her name was Sheryl as well, and she said, it's so sad that this is your last course because this is something you'd be very good at.
Oh, so then it took you
a while.
Half of your career,
exactly.
Or most of your career to get to the writing part.
Which is wonderful because now I'm at a point where I'm right in the middle of finalizing a book deal with a major publishing company. So I'm really thrilled about that. I'll get to write more.
And producing?
Producing came out of necessity. Producing was all and only about necessity, waving that red flag. If somebody was not going to write the projects for me, then I had to be about the business of writing the projects.
Was the Divas Simply Singing part of going to campuses?
No, Divas Simply
different.
Singing started once again around 1990 when I realized that I had to do something to forever raise up the memory of all the friends that I had lost to HIV and AIDS.
Oh, that was in conjunction with the...
Exactly.
I see.
So I created Divas Simply Singing, a night where women of power, conviction with a voice, especially a singing voice, could come with the light, the mic, and be the diva who simply sings around HIV and AIDS.
Where,
to raise awareness.
Where did you... What venues did you use?
This year, it's Saturday, October 9th at the Saban Theater, but we
it's big theaters, big,
yes.
Oh, yes.
So we're at the Saban Theater, Saturday, October 9th, and people can go to divassimplysinging.com. Don't forget that extra S between the divas and the simply, because you will go to a website that you do not want to see.
Don't say that.
Right, so go to divassimplysinging.com.
I see. Oh, I didn't know it was such a big
production. Event. It's probably...
Do you sing in it?
Yes, I do.
You do,
It's
yeah.
the longest consecutive running musical AIDS fundraiser in the nation.
Oh, that's fantastic. Okay, so we're at a big house.
Yes.
We're at the Saban Theater.
Yes.
And let's go back to Dreamgirls.
Yes.
How fabulous was that?
That
Those
was
are big houses.
That right? was another large house, the same size as the Saban.
That's
1,600 seats, and each and every night... Along with myself, Loretta Devine, Jennifer Holliday, we were greeted with the kind of applause that lets you know just how loved you are. And anybody that you could ever think of, from Michael Jackson to Elton John to Diane von Furstenberg, they were all in that audience and they would all come backstage. And it was just the most amazing time in my life.
Did you ever talk to Diana Ross about it?
I met Diana Ross in a well-documented meeting at the...
Well-documented?
Yeah, well-documented in quite a few books. And I met her at the Russian Tea Room. And I
While you were on stage? Or
no,
after?
No, it was, we were doing a, it was in between, a matinee day.
That's what I mean. While you were still running Dreamgirls?
I was still running.
Yeah.
I was still running
You were still running.
And she walked into the Russian Tea Room, and I still, to this day, have such great admiration for her, and I saw her, and I walked over to introduce myself, and she turned around, and I said, Miss Ross, I'm Sheryl. She said, I know who you are. She put a chill on me that just froze all that vodka in the Russian Tea Room, and she walked off. But I love her. You know, Diana Ross, you know, she was upset by what she thought, you know, that the piece
right.
was about. And it was never about the Supremes. Never. Because I've got to tell you, They told me, never play Diana Ross, because if you do, they'll sue us.
Oh, so you were very aware of it from the beginning.
I was very aware.
Who wrote it?
It was written by Tom Ion, God bless his soul.
Fantastic.
It was all his idea.
Fantastic.
You know, Michael Bennett gets a lot of the credit, but it was all the out of the head of Tom Ion.
Tom Ion was an icon on the Broadway stage.
Yes!
I know, really.
What an incredible writer.
Right.
He wrote all that early material for Bette Midler when she was doing all the bathhouses. He was such a character.
So we've come full circle.
Yes.
We're finished.
Oh, it was great talking to you.
But you stay on this merry-go-round.
Thank you. You know I'm not stopping.
No, I know. And hats off to you.
Thank you. I hope your viewers will please go to divasimplysinging.com, book their tickets. They'll be on sale June 1st.
And look for it every year.
Every
this will
year.
Be playing
this is
year,
year
after year. Thank
this,
you.
Please.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching this part. We'll be right back with Karen Landry. Hi, I'm Joan Quinn, and welcome back to the Joan Quinn Profiles. I'm here with actress, director, Karen Landry. I want to say soundtrack artist.
Nope, that's not me.
That's not you, because I didn't know what that was. A
soundtrack
artist.
That would be recording musician.
But that says it on the internet. That you're a soundtrack artist,
really?
And gave some films that you, I wondered if it was voiceover.
Oh, yes, actually, that is
And
true.
That's what they call it. Anyway, she was born and raised in Minneapolis, Minnesota. She went to McAllister College and the University of Minnesota. She's been working as a professional actress for over 30 years, from off-Broadway to the Midwest to the West Coast. She's been on stage, TV, and in film, and Karen is actually teaching acting at UCLA's entertainment, what do we call it? Studies.
Entertainment studies.
If I didn't mention it, we have to also know that she's a director, mm-hmm. and I think that's why you're here to talk about your play. Did you plan to be an actress?
You know, it struck me when I was very young that I wanted to do it. Every time the schools did a play, I'd be out there in the front row, you know.
Oh, you were?
It just was a thing. I was a young exhibitionist.
In Minneapolis?
To, yeah.
But there's a lot of great theater there.
There's a lot of great theater, so I think I got the idea because my parents took us to plays.
They
took us to plays a lot.
But they weren't in show business.
No. My dad was a dentist, my mom was a housekeeper, and a very, very smart lady. Very smart.
So you had that. You earned your MFA from University of Minnesota. And in acting, but that then led to something at the Guthrie.
Yes, the Guthrie Theater, at that time, the Bush Fellowship is an award that I won, and that gave me graduate school and a guaranteed year at the Guthrie.
A year? Doing a year. What?
Doing all the plays, and I was supposed
you
to
mean
be...
You acting, actually,
acting.
In
mm-hmm.
every play that they put on?
Yeah. And it was sort of as an internship, but it was a paid position. You would be a journeyman actor. But what happened was I had done Streetcar Named Desire while I was a student at the University of Minnesota. And my director, Charles Nolte, was a Broadway star.
Oh.
And he was best friends with Tennessee Williams, who was still alive at that time. So Tennessee Williams comes to see our play.
In Minneapolis.
Our production of Streetcar Named Desire in Minneapolis. And because he came, the artistic director, Michael Langham, at the time of the Guthrie, came to see the production, and they decided to do Streetcar, and they gave me a chance, and they had me play Stella.
That's how you got to Broadway? I mean, to off-Broadway?
No, off-Broadway came later, but
came later, but that was...
But I had my start right after. I was very, very
Oh, you mean right
fortunate.
When you came out of college, is what you're saying?
I went right to professional theater, because the Guthrie is a huge, it's a 1,400-seat theater. It was the first regional theater in the United States.
That was the old Guthrie.
Mm-hmm.
And now the new Guthrie is several theaters.
Yeah, there's three of them.
I know.
There's the Thrust, that's the three-quarter stage. Then there's a proscenium stage that they'd never had before. and a black box where there's a lot of experimental theater.
And so it is it the same number of seats as the Olga through the one theater?
The Thrust the is, yeah. I believe.
Yeah. So have you been there? Have you worked there?
I have not worked there yet, but I came close. I had a conflict the last time they
It's fantastic. It's such a beautiful building, and it's right on the river.
It's wonderful.
It's so, it's like,
a French architect designed it.
It's a perfect way to go to the theater.
It is.
Have dinner, look across the river.
They have that feature on the building called the Never Ending Bridge.
Yes.
It just sticks
yeah,
out.
I know.
And you walk in, it's the strangest sensation. It's like you're jutted out over the river, and it's just a beautiful
it's
view.
It's great. It's really nice. So why did you leave?
Yeah, Minneapolis.
Minneapolis.
Well, it was a hard thing to do, but everybody feels when you're from the Midwest, like, oh, if you haven't done something in New York or L.A., then you haven't made it all the way to the top.
So do you go to New York or do you go to L.A.?
Right,
when
that's
you
the
leave.
Big question. That's do you take a left? Do you take a right? So I was going to go to New York, and a director, the one, Ken Ruta, who's a wonderful actor, and he directs opera here on the West Coast, and he said, go west, young woman.
Oh,
he
did.
Said, if you're interested in film and television, and he said, I happen to think you'd be good at it, you got to go young. So he said, you've already done better theater than there is sometimes in New York, because back in the day that I was at the Guthrie, you did work all 9 months of the year.
That's why I was surprised when you said that, because you played in everything. It was like an ensemble,
yes.
More so than it is now, I guess.
More so. And you were hired for 3 years I did 27 plays.
That's fantastic, isn't it?
It was wonderful.
And then when you came here, was it hard to get work?
For anybody, yeah, it takes a while. You have to get the agent first.
Right. And I was going to ask you about that. How do you do that?
Well, you hopefully have film on yourself, which I did because I'd done commercials and some independent film in Minneapolis.
So there must not have been much film in Minneapolis. Yeah. Some production, probably.
Yeah, back then, before digital film, there wasn't as much independent film, but I did a couple, and there were commercials galore.
And then, so when you came out, you did get can you get them by recommendation, like, say, with Mr. Ruta suggesting it?
In fact, put me with his agent, but they weren't the ones that ultimately I went with, but Gary Salt was his name. He was with the Paul Kohner Agency, a beautiful.
Oh, yeah.
He was so gracious, and he helped me understand the town.
But that was great that you had an entree, because that's very difficult, even if you didn't go with them. And then you got, after that, I guess you got lots of TV roles. You've been on lots and lots of TV shows. What kind of roles do you usually play?
I was the wholesome Midwest girl.
I wonder why.
That thing works for a while. The earthy, you know, wholesome. A lot of serious, but some comedy. I had fun doing Family Ties and, I don't know if the names are just going to fly on my head.
Oh, I know. How can
but
you
I had learn? 3 years on St. Elsewhere as the wife of the doctor that never did anything right.
So that was the recurring?
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. That was wonderful. And I did Lou Grant and Trapper John and all those.
And you also have been on stage with your husband.
Yes.
Is that good?
It is good. We've done movies together. We've written screenplays together. And now we've been acting in plays together.
And now you're directing him.
Yeah.
Are you acting in this play as well?
No.
You're just directing. So tell us about the play and who wrote it. And
Jesse Boy is a brand new play. It's a world premiere. And it's written by a very talented young man who's from West Virginia, but went to New York City and studied there for years and has done a lot of theater, and he's done his own films. And his name is Robert Mollahan.
Mollahan, spelled kind of funny.
M-O-L-L-O-H-A-N. Really, he's a handsome, talented young man. He sings and he writes beautifully. He's got the Southern thing.
And that's what this story has,
Southern
that
Appalachia.
Southern bent.
Mm-hmm.
And what's it about?
It's about family and dysfunction and abuse and autism and Elvis impersonation. Robert's in the play himself.
And is he? Is he an actor?
He is an actor. He's brilliant. He's wonderful.
And your husband's in the play.
And he's brilliant.
Is he hot?
I can say that for sure.
I had Jamie Page on, and she's in the play.
Oh, you had her on?
Yes.
She's wonderful.
She's beautiful.
From my hometown.
I know she is.
She's so fabulous.
And I said, how do they get along? What is that? And she said, very professional. I was watching to see how that worked, because that's how it has to be, right?
Exactly. Exactly. It was a very intense rehearsal period.
Did you cast it?
Mm-hmm.
And then so then you cast it and then you go through. Did your husband have to audition?
Oh, no. No. In fact, I was more or less begging him. But
oh, you were begging him.
I didn't have to beg hard once he read the play. He saw the part and he went, oh, my gosh, I love this.
Really?
Yeah, he did. And he was excited by the work.
So where is the theater?
The Ruskin Theater is located at the Santa Monica Airport.
It's so great there, isn't it?
Yeah, it is.
Lots of parking.
It is. It's so you drive up, you park, you walk in.
I know. That's what's so great about doing something like that. And they have a group there.
Yes, it's a school.
Is it a school? Yeah.
And it's a theater company. It's both. And the school is Meisner-based, Sanford Meisner.
Have you taught there at all?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you have? Oh, mm-hmm. That's great. And so you still teach at UCLA, or you did?
I have not. In the last year, I've had too many projects come up. But they hired you on the basis of being a professional. So there's an acceptance of that. It's not the actual college itself. It's a professional program that's in the extension,
but that's great.
And they use professional people.
Yeah, that's great. And so you're actually doing the same thing at the Ruskin, mm-hmm. teaching. You have two daughters.
Yes, I do.
Will they follow in your footsteps?
I think so, but they're very smart. my youngest is a dancer. She's right now dancing as well as acting and making a wonderful living as one of the best Pilates trainers you've ever
seen. Oh, so that's a great thing to go
into.
Like athletes will go into coaching and training, doing different things.
I was very lucky in my lifetime that I've pretty much gone from acting job to acting job, but it's not easy. And there were times, you know, when it was very slow and the teaching fills in. But
that's what I meant, commercial work or whatever you can do.
So I said to them, both Chris and I said early on, you know, get your other game going, get a plan B. So my oldest daughter's moved up to San Francisco. She loves it up there, and she's doing a play currently at the New Conservatory.
Oh, she is. So they are following in your footsteps. Are they Mulkey?
Yes, they both go Mulkey. Amelia Mulkey and Elizabeth Mulkey. They've both worked at the Ruskin Theater.
Oh, they have.
Yeah, Amelia was sort of instrumental in getting us involved. She started taking classes there years ago, and she designed the poster that you'll see.
Oh, that's right, Jesse Boy. She did. Mm-hmm. Fantastic. Well, I thank you so much for coming.
Oh, you're lovely to talk to. Thank you so much.
Thank you for watching. Write to jaquinn1@aol.com. And 777 South Figueroa, 44th floor, Los Angeles, 90017. See you next time on the Joan Quinn Profiles.